Hello, welcome at Mount Game Coding. This time we'll be making Space Invaders in Unity using the empty game Unity project from the GitLab. Let's dive right into it. So here, if we go to GitLab and we go to groups, Mount Game Coding group, we can see there's this empty game project Unity we created in the previous video. So if you want to know how we got this, check out the previous videos. Well, let's go to it. We're going to use it as our base. I'm going to fork it. And I'm going to put it in my local namespace. I will move it to the Mount Game Coding group so you can copy, fork, or do whatever with the project you like. So let's change the name. Here, advanced, save the videos, yeah, good, okay, and Space Invaders Unity, and paste it here, rename the project, is that possible? Yes, we're gonna remove the fork. Okay, so now we can move it to our group folder here, transfer, confirm, let it do the job. Let's go to groups. Here it is, Space Invaders Unity. Perfect. So let's check it out. Go to Visual Studio. It's in Team Explorer, we're gonna clone the URL, we're gonna put it Space Invaders Unity, let's call it like we see it. Great, clone, wait a little and it will arrive up. And it arrived. Okay, we close Visual Studio. And the next thing we need to do is I'm going to change the name here to Space Invaders Unity. And that's it. Okay. Let's open Unity. Select folder. Importing, holding on tight to my keyboard and mouse. Okay, and what do we have? Scene, build settings, scene is gone. But so let's open it, add open scene. Okay, there's something wrong there. And for example, if you want to change the product name, you can call it Space Invaders Unity like this, right? Okay. Script is missing, game object. Okay, let's open the script in Visual Studio. If you want to know how to make this connection, check out our previous videos. Normally you develop games in Mono develop, but you can also use Visual Studio. If you would like to know how, check out the video. And let's make it a dark, very dark blue background, and Everything here should be fine. See if we can run the game. Set something with an asset database. Script which isn't. So now we'll remove this. The game is running. I'll remove it. Okay. Save. And now the first thing we're gonna do is create the world. So we have our scene, we have our editor, we have our inspector, we have our scene object list. So let's turn game object into world, and let's give the world our game objects, like the enemy, player, and the bullet. And these objects, they also need a script. So let's create the script here, create player. And bullet. The thing we do with this script is we're gonna attach them to our objects. So the player will receive a player script, we'll just drag it into the inspector. The enemy will get an enemy script, and we also drag it into the inspector. We select bullet and we drag the bullet script into the inspector. And we save. So, nice. And the next step is to commit what we have. So let's do that. Let's try and commit our changes. So set up the space invaders scene and add scripts for each world object. And it removes a lot of things, so we'll add a lot of things. We'll leave that up to the version control. So we pull, we push, and we will just... Okay. So this is working fine. I shouldn't forget to commit changes regularly. So in the world, let's go to world and create the player. So the player needs to have some visual thingy, right? So I'm going to choose sprite renderer, and I'm going to choose a default image just from the system and work with that. So I'll give my ship a width of 8 and a height of 2, a bit wide. The enemy, I'll position it somewhere, and a nice location would be down here, minus 4, let's round it, and in the center, good. Enemy also gets a visual, make it red, same sprite, give it a different size, square, and we'll move it upwards, and 4 seems to do nice, do well, nicely, well, okay. And the bullet also gets a sprite, here it is, white sprite, and it has a height, yes, 1, 3, okay, and we'll keep it in the same non-color as the player's color. Run. Okay, everything is fine. Save it and see if we can commit anything. Yeah. The visuals of the game objects sync, pull, push, and we go back to the script. Okay, so we have our scripts, we have our objects, our world. Next thing we need to do is make our enemy move. Now we can choose to do that. So let's do that. So we have our enemy here, and we want to give our enemy a speed. So we'll do a private int speed, and we will set the speed to we'll create a reset button. We set the speed to 4, and we will call reset from start. Okay, and in update we will make the player move, or the enemy move, transform. We will use the transform position to update the movement. And an object in the scene has a transform component, and this component holds a position, and that's the position in the world. So we can see the X value moves while I drag the object left and right. So the left side is -8, and the right side is 8, and the center is 0. So the enemy should be able to move from 0 to -8 and from -8 to 8. And I think this screen has 16:10, that's also the aspect ratio. Let's use those numbers. So the transform position is new vector 3, it's a 3D position with X, Y, and Z. And we want to really make sure that the Y and Z are the same, and we only change the X value. So let's do that. Let's change the X value according to the speed. And we want to use the delta time. So the speed is 4 per second. The delta time is the time between frames, so we'll take a fraction of the speed if multiple frames are played within 1 second. And then the total of it will equal the full amount of speed. Full speed amount. Okay. So let's say we have 3 frames in a second. Then it will have, for example, the time would be 0.333 times the speed, so there will be 1/3 of the speed in each of the 3 frames. Just one example, and in the end it will have the position will have changed with 4. So let's run it. Let's see if an argument is missing. Transform speed and set. And I wonder, where is the argument missing? What did I miss? I didn't save. Save your files. Okay, now we'll move out of the screen. Okay, great. So the next thing we need to check is bounce. So we'll check the bounce. So if it hits the side, and we know that the sides are located at -8 and 8, the horizontal bound. So if the transform position is greater than 8, it will need to do something. And smaller than -8, it will need to do something. And the thing it needs to do is invert speed. Then it will go the opposite direction. Recording, yes. No, because we don't call check bounce, so it also will not bounce. And the center of the object, it takes the center of the object as its position, so it will go a little bit out of the screen, and we don't want that. So we need to find the object's size. And the way we can do that is by accessing its component. So we want to know what how big the sprite is and get the size from it. So I'm gonna do game object dot get component, then sprite renderer. And from the sprite renderer you can get the bound, and from the bound the size, and from the size the width. So x is the width. And we want half the width, and we want to store it in a float, and we call it object's width divided by 2. So if it moves to the right, we want to add it. And if it moves to the left, we want to subtract it. So we scan with the edges of the object. So now we want to use this side to detect if it hits the edge. Yes, and now we will use the left side. Yes. Okay. So this is working fine. Now the other thing we need to do is make the object go down whenever it hits the side. And now we want to know the height, and not half the height, the full height. And we use the y for it. So each time, or every time it hits the side, we will make it move or go down. And we don't change the horizontal, we'll change the vertical position. We subtract the height and then it will move down. Let's see, this we change the speed. Make it move down, and it should also go to the left. So when it moves down, let's align it to the sides. So the side is 8 minus the object's width. And to the right, it's minus 8 plus the object's width. Let's see how it bounces. Okay, it seems to function well. We'll keep it this way. So we restore the value to the side of the screen, and we make it move down, and we make it go to the other side the next frame. Then we check bounce again and we repeat. So this is our enemy. Up next is our player. We want the player to be able to move to the left and the right. So we need some input for that, because it's user control, not computer control. Handle input. And we call handle input in update. And we're gonna access the access. I'm gonna ask the horizontal access, and I'm gonna ask if it's smaller than 0. Else, if it's bigger than 0, otherwise, we'll set the speed. We can just copy all the speed functionality, and we will set the speed to 0. Speed is 7, minus 7. So we go to the left negative, to the right positive, and we use the axis. Okay, so where did we get the axis? The axis, if you go to Edit, Project Settings, Input, you can see the input controls. So here we have the input controls, for example, horizontal, vertical, fire 1, 2, 3, jump, submit, cancel. So the horizontal value can go from minus 1 to 1, and it has some properties like its name and its what buttons need to be pressed. So if I press the left or the right button, it will adjust that value. And this is how we retrieve the value between minus 1 and 1. So let's run the game. I didn't connect it yet. Update, handle input. For the player, speed. I didn't connect, like, change its position. So let's do this. Speed delta time. So that's the same as for the enemy. Only the way we trigger the speed is different. Okay, so here we go. I hit it and I let it go, and you can see there's a delay. Or if you try it, you can feel there's a delay. This delay is because of the sensitivity and the gravity. Here, the sensitivity is the speed to move towards target value for digital devices, units per second. So how fast does it go from 0 to minus 1 or from 0 to 1? So we want to increase this value, so it will do it very fast. And the other thing is how it will decrease, how fast it will decrease from minus 1 to 0 or from 0 to 1. So as long as the value is above 1 or above 0, smaller than 0, it will move the player, and we don't want that. We want to return quickly from 0 to 1 and from 1 to 0, or from 0 to minus 1 and from minus 1 to 0. So we set the value really high so it goes really fast, and this gives a more instant reaction in controls. A small detail, but this feels better. The other way, it feels more like it's on ice or something. Okay, took some water. So we can move the player. The player can move out of the screen at the moment, and we don't want that. So also for the player, we're gonna add and check for the boundaries. So check bounds. We take the width of the object, and then we're gonna see if it's on the side of the screen, and if it is, we'll just stop the motion. Right, speed 0, that's fine, because we're gonna lock it to the side of the screen. Let's see if this will work. Yeah, cannot go to the left, cannot go to the right. So that's perfect. We're gonna keep it like that. Next is the bullet. Wanna fire something. Or in the meantime, I already forgot to change this. Add enemy code, add player code. Which namely movement code, right? Be specific. Sync, push, and pull. Pull and push the other way around. Okay, maybe it's getting late. So a bullet. So the bullet, the bullet has a lot of characteristics which are similar to the player and enemy, such as the speed. Copy that. The Oh, it has a transform. Let's update. The bullet will receive check bounce. It leaves the screen. And the bullet will get a fire. Method, which can be fire. Fire will be called from the player. That's that. And that will be done when. Well, let's first go to bullet and factor 3 move position. Transform position is no position. Okay. And we want to deactivate the bullet when the game starts, because now when we start the game, the bullet is visible. We don't want that. And we only want it to be visible when we fire the bullet. And to do so, we go to reset and we game object set active. And we set active to false. So now when we fire, we set it to true. Let that be the first thing we do. And we only want to it to be true when it's false. So if game object self is no active self is false. So only when it's false we can fire a bullet. So we don't have. So it needs to hit something or leave the screen before we can fire a new bullet. So that's why we set it to false. And when it's false, we can set it to active. And then when it leaves the screen, we will fix this check bounce. It will set it back to false. And when it collides with something, we also set it to false. And now we want the player to be able to fire the bullet. So input, get button down. So this is different. You have axis and a button. The button is for the other commands like fire. And I'll show you. So if we go to edit, project settings, input, fire 1, for example, is left control. And you also fire 2, which is left alt, 3 is left shift, then we have submit, is return, submit, enter, jump, joystick, another jump, is space. So a joystick or a space both activate the jump command. And we can listen to it, but we listen to fire 1, this is the left control. If it is true, so if it has been pressed down, we want the bullet to fire. And the way we can do that is by making a reference in the player to the bullet. Let's do this. Bullet fire. And the position will be the transform position. So that's the player's position, the ship's position. So this is ready. So I created this reference here. It's empty. We don't set it in the class, but the way we can set it, because it's public, it will appear in the editor. Wonderful thing of Unity. So let's go to the player, and now when we go to the script, we see here bullet. So we can drag from the scene list the bullet into that variable, and it will link to the bullet script, to the bullet component. So now they're connected, and now this value will not be null, but it will be the reference to bullet, and so we can call fire on it. Let's test. So it's gone, deactivated. Now we press left control, and it appears. It just doesn't move into a good direction. Let's fix that. Transform. So we don't want it to travel over the X, but over the Y axis. and we want to travel up, up, and up is negative. So here we have speed. Speed isn't being set yet, so we need to do that. We do that in fire, and the speed value will be 7. Let's run and play. And okay, it's into the wrong direction. So we'll add the speed to it. Let's just check. So the -4 is low, down, and positive is up. The negative is down, positive is up. So indeed, we need to add value to go up in the positive direction. And let's return just to the original. Okay, great. Bounce. So let's check these bounds. We only need to check the Y and only up. So if the position of the object is plus 5, and we want to use half the height, not the width. We don't need the width. Yeah, oh, here we can keep it. We just want to divide the height by 2. Because we move up, we use the height and we subtract the height from our position. Then we know when the object has fully moved past the top line of the screen, the upper bounds. And let's test it. And it goes up and it disappears, and we cannot shoot anymore. Okay, so we want to reset the moment it leaves the screen. Check bounds like this. So if it moves out of the screen, reset the bullet, and then we can fire again. And there it goes, and we can fire again. Now I can keep pressing, but it will only fire when it's inactive. Okay. So another part completed. Let's commit. Changes. And let's commit all those changes. Add bullet and fire command to player. Bullet. Logic and fire command. Input and to player. Okay, sync, pull, and push. There we go. Next step is collision, I think, right? We need the bullet and things to collide. So for collision, we need to add 2 components. One is the rigid body and the other one is the collider. So let's first add a rigid body. We are making a 2D game, so we choose the 2D physics on everything. Physics 2D, rigid body on enemy, on bullet, and on player. And I'm gonna remove the gravity and the drag, everything. Okay, and they will receive a box collider. So as soon as we add a box collider, it will add some boundaries for collision. So we are adding it to the player. So if we look at the scene editor, we can see a green box appear if I click it. There you go. There you have it. Now do the same for the enemy. Also a box collider, and also for the player. And it will calculate the size automatically, and I'm editing them all to the same object. Okay. And with the box collider, we will use it as a trigger. We don't want them to bounce or stop or anything. We want to know when they overlap, so when the triggers are overlapping each other. So So we'll use them as a trigger, these collision details. Okay, so our objects have collision components, and what we can do in code is now add the code part, and that's editing a method which will be called when an event is sent out. And the one we want is on trigger enter 2D. Okay. And then if you can use the other's object, that's the other collision object. Game object name is. So if the collision game object, its name is a certain name, for example, here we have the bullet. If the bullet gets hit by the enemy, it needs to disappear, right? We want to reset it. Reset. So there will be reset. And we copy this code, we pass it in enemy, and if the enemy is hit by the bullet, we want it to reset, or we want it to deactivate. So set active will be set to false. So it will be deactivated. And also if the enemy hits the player. Or it is the player. Okay, so we copy this, and the player can die. It will be game over if it will be hit by the enemy. So also deactivate the player. Okay. And let's see if this will work. We shoot, we wait, and now we hit the. So you saw the bullet and the enemy disappeared when one of them was hit. So let's speed up the enemy, make it 40, and if it hits the player should disappear. The enemy as well. There you go. So this is good. Let's reset the speed and let's commit these changes. So we have collision detection, or almost there. We need to create score and game over. Let's first create those elements and then add it to code. So we go back to the scene list, and what we're going to do is add a new right mouse click in the middle, and you can then you get this pop-up, and we go to UI and we click on text, and when we click text we also get a canvas and an event system, and you saw it appear in the scene editor. If you didn't, rewind the movie a little bit and check the changes. So we have a canvas, and on this canvas we can have UI elements, and we have one UI element which is the text, and we will call it point, and I will position it somewhere in the screen, and I'll give it a white color so it's better viewable. So here the alignment anchors will anchor it to the left top corner, and we'll give it a size of say 100 by 30. And wanted to give it a different size here, maybe this should be bigger. Yes, 32. And now let's make sure it aligns more nicely. Okay, let's round it 50, no, 52 by 20. Okay, left center 54. Okay, so here we have our score. And the next thing is we're gonna add a panel for game over. Again, I go to the drop down, panel, I'm gonna change the color, make it darker and less transparent, so we can just barely view through it. Okay. And the panel is full screen. And I'm gonna add a text and game over. This will let the player know it's game over. Okay. So here we have our panel, game over. Or this is the text, and that's the panel. Panel, game over. This is the text, game over. Okay. Let's change this name to text points. So we're gonna put this on inactive. So initially it will be invisible, and when the game ends, whether the player dies or the enemies have been killed, this panel will appear. So that's the functionality we're going to create. And we're gonna do that through the world. The world gets references, will create references in the world to text points and panel game over. That's our next. And the world has the script game manager, and the game manager can have those variables. So the thing we need for this is the Unity UI space, namespace. Now we can have the text, it will be points, and we can have rec transform, which will be the game over. Let's connect them. World. They should appear any second now. Did I save? Yes. Okay, now drag the objects into them again. Yep, now the references exist, otherwise they're null. We get no pointer, reference, exception, errors. And besides points, we also have score, which is an integer, and how is it? Let's create a method game point, and let's create a method update UI, which will set the score, which will change the text into the score. And so this value left top will change from 0 to the score, so 1 for example. Game point will make it public, so other objects can trigger it. Let's make a method set game over, and this set game over will make sure that the panel, game over panel, will be activated. So game over will become true. Start will be false. Let's make a reset method set colored from start, and the score will also be set to 0 in the beginning. And we will also call the DHY after we've done that. So we do that after the reset, but also after gaining points. Okay. So it's not connected to when the player dies or the enemies are gone. But let's commit these parts. Changes. Add game kernel score in UI and logic in game manager. Sync it, we'll pull and we'll push. Sure. We can trust this. And now, how to connect the panel and the points to gameplay. So, what we will do is in enemy, player, and bullet, access the game manager. We can do that the following way. So in start, there's a global object with methods we can access to find the world. So when we call find, it is able to find the root objects like the world, the canvas, the main camera, and we will search for the world, and then we will try to get its component, the script. When it found the world object, we do get component, and can get either of these components, transform or game manager, and we will find the game manager and return it. So this is the right location, only it shouldn't be game over, but game manager is okay. So also for player, also for bullet, I'm also gonna add this to. Okay. Now next is when an enemy is deactivated, or when the bullet is deactivated by an enemy, the player gets a point. When you successfully hit an enemy, you get a point. You can also do it here on destroy enemy. It depends on your game rules, but this works fine. One shot kills one enemy, they both disappear. Mission complete. To be sure, you can say you can only destroy another enemy when you are active yourself. So when the bullet is active, collision game object prompt dot active self. So if it's active and it's the bullet, it can be destroyed. This way you can only destroy one enemy. And theoretically the overlap of the bullet could be overlapping two enemies. If you shoot them in the middle, maybe, but yeah, we only have one, so practically it's not possible. But let's just edit. Let's just test it as well. See if there are no compile issues. Okay, so it hit the enemy, didn't destroy the enemy. And that's probably because this code is executed first, before the code of the enemy. So the enemy should actually deactivate the bullet. Can we do that? Set active false. Okay, let's test again. So then the bullet should not set it. Put itself, deactivate itself. But we need to put it to be deactivated, yeah. Okay. Ah, didn't save. Okay, of course. Well, let's revert that code. Yeah. Since it's theoretical, let's just maybe another video if we also expand with lines of enemies, rows of enemies, we could look into it. Might be a little design flaw. Okay, good. Let's go back to the gaining points, ending the game. So game manager, update. So the check end. Check game over. Here we have set game over, check game over. And this will be if score equals 1. Then the player has destroyed all enemies, so it's game over. The other way to get game over is to for when the player is deactivated. Check game over should be done in update. Cool. Okay, game over. In the background you can still see the player move. And we need something to reset the game. So in game over, just like handle input, the fire button. In we're just gonna copy the all handle input and remove this. Place the call to handle input method in update, so it will be called every frame. Every frame the input will be checked. We're gonna use the submit from previously. You might remember that that is enter or return, and enter or return should reset the game. And this should happen if it's not, if the game is not game over. when do we know when the game is game over? If the game over object is false, active self. If that is false, we can press the submit button to reset the game. Let's see. We can press enter and nothing happens. Okay, what did we miss? Handle input. The button is down. Game over. Active is false. Reset the game. Reset the game setting to zero. Updates the UI. And removes the game over. Screen. But it doesn't. Oh, only when it's active, of course, not when it's inactive. Yes, okay. And then we need to reset everything. And the way we can do that is by storing all the objects in the manager, and then we can control their reset behavior, for example. Reset. And they all need to be public. We need to, in the world, make the link. So they will appear shortly, I hope. Only when I make them public. Try again. There they are. I'll make the link. So the references are correct. Okay, I'll save. And let's just run the game. Okay, things are reset, but we don't notice anything. So we made some changes. Let's commit. So link the game objects to the game manager. So the enemy, it will be deactivated, so we need to inactivate, make it active again, just to be sure. Also do it to the player, and the bullet should be false. Okay, speeds are reset. Another thing we need to do is the location, because I think when we win the game, location are the latest ones and not the original ones. Yes, so let's do that. So we're gonna store the original location in the factory. Position original. I'm gonna do that the very first thing in start, new factor. And we're gonna take the transform XYZ, the current XYZ which have been set in the editor. It will take those values, the player, the bullet, and the enemy. It will store it for later use, and later use each is when we reset. So when we reset the things, we give it their original position back. That sounds nice, right? Let's see if it works. Yes. So yeah, you can still move the player, see that. That may be nice, a nice effect. Okay. Okay. This is it. Let's commit. Reset objects. Game over. Right now, so you can use this source. It's all pushed to the repository. You can find it at GitLab Mount Game Coding group, and then the Space Invaders Unity. Maybe later on there will be some more updates to this version. But when you watch the video, you know that this commit 2F3FTA4A is the 10 August. This is where we ended. And hope you liked it. Make sure to subscribe, like, dislike. Send us comments, let us know what you like, what you didn't like, maybe request, and yeah, that's it. Have a nice day, and hope to see you later. Bye.